this is Gilbert Gottfried, and I'm here with my co-host Frank Santopadre, and this is Gilbert and Frank's Amazing Colossal Obsessions.
It's like Orson Welles. You're so silky smooth.
The Martians are coming. The Martians are coming.
Colossal Obsessions.
We just had the legendary Buck Henry on the show telling us a very funny Orson Welles story. And the helicopter story.
Oh, yes.
Which we'll talk about.
Finally, someone who was there.
In a future episode.
And can we talk about...
We'll do that with Paul.
Oh, okay.
Yeah. We'll do that in our housekeeping.
Paul Schofield is coming in next.
Really? Yes. He died a few years ago. That's a hell of a booking.
But he likes this podcast so much.
Man, that's for all seasons. Our guest is actually humorist Dylan Brody, who is a fan of yours and a fan of the show.
I'll be playing the part of Dylan Brody
and he'll
for the
be playing
of this
the part.
Podcast.
Welcome, Dylan.
Well, thank you for coming in. I will tell you, I should tell you how much of a fan I am of Gilbert. So I was
Go ahead, he likes that.
Out in the outer room. When I was 17, I was starting to do stand-up comedy at open mics. I had learned from the movie Fame that if you want to be a comic, what you do is you write 5 minutes and you go to the Catch a Rising Star and you showcase and then you are a professional stand-up comic.
Yes.
Because that's how it works in the real world. And I went into Catch a Rising Star just to see a show before I was going to showcase there. And it was, you know, the lineup of comics and a few singers. And Gilbert, you were on the lineup. And you were having a bit of a difficult time on stage.
This is shocking.
And you did a thing that the audience was not for. You were annoyed with them. And you began to do what was clearly a Zen in the Art of Motorcycle Persig reference, in which you were saying, okay, the jokes about the city are too big. I'll do jokes about just this building, just this. I will do jokes about just this one brick on the wall. And I will do that until you laugh. And nobody was coming with you. And abruptly, you did something which I'm guessing was not wholly improvised, but I was young enough not to know the difference yet. You grabbed one of the open-backed chairs, draped it over your shoulders so that the legs of the chair were sticking up from your back, and you said, one day, Gregory woke up and found he was a brontosaurus.
A Kafka reference.
How would he tell his wife? What would his friends think? Where would he buy suits? And I could not stop laughing for the remainder of the evening. It didn't matter what you said. You left the stage. Other people were up. I was still laughing at Kafka.
Wow.
And I have been quoting it ever since. And now my wife quotes it. Anytime we feel entirely out of place and alienated from the world, she will turn to me and say, one day Gregory woke up.
Isn't that nice?
And that's you did that at me.
Although
and
it,
to me.
It was a Tyrannosaurus.
Those are
the ones with the spikes sticking up.
No, you mean a Stegosaurus.
It could have been either one.
Well, it could have been, but I'm pretty sure you said Brontosaurus at the time, but what do I know?
Yeah.
Does a T-Rex have spikes?
The T-Rex, no.
No, the T-Rex has the little tiny short arms.
But the Stegosaurus would have spikes.
Triceratops and the Triceratops had three horns.
Right. Yes.
And the Stegosaurus had...
That's where you look up synonyms.
Yeah.
Right.
Yeah, in a Stegosaurus.
Right.
Yeah.
Right. So you have the only comedy act in the world that freely references not only Kafka, but Norman Fell. That, my friends, is diversity.
And you know what someone reminded me of?
Wouldn't it be weird if we knew what someone reminded you of?
Yes.
That would be bizarre.
Someone reminded me that... When I would do my Ben Gazzara
bit,
that I would mention
Tony
Lobianco.
Yes, I saw that.
And I didn't bring that up to him.
We should have. Now you're going to kick yourself. I got to get Tony back for a mini episode.
Yeah, just to have him sit
right.
in for that.
Right.
That's very funny.
Because I finally got John Amos to go, damn.
A Good Times reference. We had John Amos in
very nicely done.
The other night.
But my question for you, and I do want to know this.
Yes.
What were your first showcases like when it was the beginning of comedy in New York as we knew it in the 80s? Do you remember your early showcases at the main clubs?
I forget the first one I went to. I always thought it was Bitter End. But then I found out it wasn't that one. and I forget the name, but there was some club that you just went in and you wrote your name down.
Right, the open mics.
Yeah. And they would have, back then, it was not just, later on it became just comedians. Back then it used to be comedians and singers.
Right. Right. And most of the real comedy clubs even did a comic and then a singer and then a comic and a singer and then.
Yeah. And Pat Benatar started there, Patty Smythe.
Oh, well, Pat Benatar was a waitress at the at Catch.
Oh, yeah.
And she was living in my old building on 81st Street.
Oh, wow.
Yeah, and Rick Newman was managing her, I believe.
Yes.
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 Weird.
And interestingly, also managing your old building.
That's strange. Yeah. Yeah.
She was the janitor.
Dylan is a humorist. He doesn't like to be called a comic. He made the journey from a comic.
I made the journey from comic to humorist. And now when I'm performing places, I tell the MC, please say that I'm a humorist and storyteller. Don't mention the word comic. Don't mention the word comedian. And they inevitably then go on stage and say, okay, so this next guy isn't a comic. He's, don't tell him what I'm not. That's not a helpful intro at all.
You open for David Sedaris on occasion.
I do all kinds of things. He's a very kind man.
And I think I saw you at the George Carlin tribute in 2010.
Yes, you would have seen me.
I was talking to Whoopi about that today. Did she host that event?
She hosted it. I will tell you a thing. I've been trying to actually get in touch with her because I wanted her to come to my show while I'm in town.
Uh-huh.
She won't. I came off stage. I did a story that I've been doing for a long time about my brief interaction with George Carlin and my immortal dog of my childhood who still roams upstate New York ownerless. And I came off stage. And as I was walking off stage, Whoopi shook my hand and said, that was brilliant. That was fantastic. And then went on stage and did a callback to my story and went on with the show. I had a very weird and surreal night that night. I was friends with Ben Stiller when we were children. We both went to the same summer camp. He does not remember this. But his mom came up to visit at one point, Ann Mira, and she said, I would like to take you out to dinner, invite a friend. And he said, oh, I'd like to bring Dylan. And I was 9 or 10, and I confused her by insistently asking questions about the Compass Players. And she was going, how do you know anything about the Compass Players? What is wrong with you? You should be asking me questions about baseball cards and comic books. This is not
but
right.
But you were a comedy nerd.
But I was a comedy nerd, right. And I knew Compass Players. And
right.
And but so
Shelley Berman and all those people.
And Paul Dooley.
Paul Dooley, we had him on the show.
Paul Dooley, I've worked with a bunch on
was
the.
Was Paul Sand in the Compass Players? I think he was.
Or, he may not have come in until
Second City. Second City. Yeah.
But Paul Dooley and I worked together on the David Feldman show for a long time.
David Feldman, there's a name.
Oh, geez.
Yeah. You did a memorable episode of his podcast.
Yes.
David is a fan, a friend and a fan.
He's a friend. I don't know if he would approve of you declaring him a fan.
He's a fan of Gilbert's, but possibly not mine. I love David. And Carl Reiner is a fan of yours.
Carl Reiner, what a sweetheart of a human.
Isn't he?
He gave me a blurb for my novel. I accidentally got him a copy of my novel. I had a manager who was deep in a midlife crisis spiral, and I did not yet know that's what was happening. He was playing make-believe with my career in very dangerous ways. And I got him my novel, and I said, please read this. I know you don't read a lot of prose. Pretend it's a screenplay. Imagine that Carl Reiner plays the grandfather. And 3 weeks later, I called him, and I said, hey, did you read the novel? He said, what novel? And I said, the one I told you to read. And he said, oh, yeah, I got that to Carl Reiner like you wanted me to. And I said, okay, that's not what I said at all. What did he say? And he said, I don't know. I'll check in. And 3 days later, I get a postcard from Carl Reiner with a totally usable blurb written on it. But I don't know if I'm allowed to use the blurb. So I call his office and I lie. And I say, I'm going to be in Beverly Hills tomorrow. Can I take you out to lunch after a meeting? And he said, no, come by the house. So suddenly I'm in Carl Reiner's house, sitting in his living room, talking to him about, at one point in this conversation, I said, it's always a relief, as it is today, when I meet one of my heroes and they turn out not to be a disappointment.
You're welcome.
Because he is like everybody else in show
Gilbert.
Business. Let's go with both of you. Yeah. You're my hero just for the socks.
I appreciate that.
He said, who was a disappointment? And I said, well, I worked for Steve Allen for a while in his office. And that was, he was the first person to make me laugh at television. And he was old and angry and crazy. This was 3 or 4 years ago. And Carl said, oh, he was so nice to me and Mel. He made our first 2,000-year-old man album.
That's right, he got them to do a 2,000-year-old man.
He produced it. He didn't take a piece of it. He just said it needed to be recorded. Boy, I hope when I get old, I'm not crazy and angry. Like, Carl, you're 114. You're going to be fine.
But he was good to you. And
he was very good to me. And then he had galleys of his children's book, and he sat down on the couch with me, and he read me his children's book and pointed things out in the picture.
That's nice.
It was like having my grandfather back for a minute.
He's a gentleman. He sang an aria.
Yeah.
Oh.
He sang an aria, and then he sang some Irish folk song.
He wanted to be an Irish tenor when he was a kid.
Oh, that's sweet.
Yeah. And he was surprisingly good.
I'm not surprised by that. He comes from an era in show business. Because he was a performer as well as a writer. You know, he was on your show of shows as a performer. And that was a time in show business when you didn't go in just because you were funny or just because you could act. You had to learn how to sing and you had to do a little soft shoe.
Absolutely.
And
he did impressions, too.
Did he really?
He did impressions when he was in the Army.
Back then, they did everything.
Yeah.
Like, so any performer you watched, they, you know, you knew they could dance. You knew they could sing.
Have you ever seen the movie Damsel in Distress?
No.
Fred Astaire, Ginger Rogers. It's Fred Astaire and some other woman. I don't remember who it is. And then George Burns and Gracie Allen.
Oh, yes.
And they dance together.
Right.
Yeah.
That's right.
And
well, they
it's
did
the
that in
only movie with Fred Astaire dancing where you're not watching him.
Yeah.
Because George dancing next to Fred is so relaxed. You know, Fred is dancing with absolute precision and perfection. And George is dancing like it's a conversation.
Well, he was a hoofer.
Yeah.
You know, they did all that stuff in vaudeville.
Yeah.
So here's a strange turn in direction.
Oh, good.
Danny Duraney, our mutual pal,
yes.
who put us together.
Yes.
A fine
man who told me that I should say hello to you, by the way, both.
He is a fine man.
He came in here and we
talked about Bob Hope's decrepitude with him for a good half an hour.
The classic Christmas special.
Have you seen the Bob Hope Christmas special, the Jack Frost that we discussed with Danny?
No.
Oh, you're in for a treat.
Is that the one that Dana Gould was on?
No. You'll see.
Okay,
dress him up as... As Frost, as Jack Frost, I was about to say David Frost.
That's a very different special.
Totally different.
They dress him up in this scary outfit as Jack Frost, and Bob Hope looks like he died 10 years before.
Right.
Yeah.
We'll send it to you.
It's horrifying.
It's life-changing.
Oh, I look forward to this.
We'll send it to you.
With eager anticipation and bated breath.
But he said you had a strange obsession with bad superhero stuff from the 1970s.
There was a thing that had... Yes.
Like $6 Million Man, or what are we talking about?
Just
Gemini
post,
Man?
Yes. Gemini Man, Man from Atlantis.
You remember these, Gil? With Patrick Duffy, the Man from Atlantis.
Ben Murphy, I believe,
ben
was
Murphy
Gemini
from
Man.
Elias Smith and Jones.
Oh, Elias Smith and Jones, I loved.
Yeah,
too.
With Pete Dool.
Not, well, but only for like two seasons. Like
well,
they
Pete
changed.
Dool shot himself.
Yeah.
Oh, is that what happened?
He shot himself.
Just playing around.
Yeah.
And I think it was a blank, but blanks are dangerous.
Yeah.
And he put it right against his head and said, oh, this show's too much. I'm going to kill myself.
And he did.
Pull the trigger and, blanks are dangerous. It's
wow.
not like in the movies where they shoot at each other with blanks and it's okay.
Wow. I did not know that. All I knew was that as a kid, suddenly there was a different guy in the role. And I thought, what happened?
Oh, right. That's right. They had to, because the show was still on and they had to replace him. So you watched these sort of cheeseball 70s.
I had been a comic book reader from the time I was very young.
Us too.
That's what you did. You read comic books and imagined.
Were you a DC guy or a Marvel guy?
First I was DC and then I grew into Marvel.
Mm-hmm.
And
me too.
There was a point at which I realized, although I didn't have this language for it yet, I realized that all the superhero comics were ultimately fascist fantasy. That all you needed was to be able to be stronger and more violent than the evil people, and then you could work your will on. And that upset me dreadfully. And then $6 Million Man came out. And
also,
there was another one that wasn't exactly a superhero show. Called It Takes a Thief.
Oh, yeah. Well, that was in the 60s with Robert Wagner.
But they were somehow rerunning it,
and
I
Fred
think.
Astaire.
At a certain, that's
oh,
right.
Oh, that's right. And what was her name? The actress.
On It Takes a Thief?
It Takes a Thief had an actress?
Yeah, didn't they have an actress?
Oh, gosh. I'm only thinking Malachi Throne was on it.
I think they had a different actress every week.
Oh,
he was
okay.
I could be wrong, though.
And I should, before I forget, I used to jerk off to Betty and Veronica.
Oh, who among us didn't?
Wait, what does that have to do with anything?
Well, it's comic books.
We were talking about comic books. And before we got too far away from it.
Yeah, you want to touch on that, so to speak.
I don't want to leave out important information.
Not Little Dot? Yeah. She didn't do it for you?
I don't want to bury the headline.
So Little Dot was for...
Remember Little Dot? Yeah, Harvey Comics. Everything had to have dots on it.
Yeah.
So you went from comic books to the $6 Million Man.
I realized that the comic books were all inherently fascist, that there was just something wrong with them. But because of the way television was evolving into a sort of a liberal medium...
You know what was a fascist comic book? Little Hitler.
Little Hitler.
Yeah,
yeah,
I hated that one.
I believe it was Lil Hitler.
Yeah.
Lil Hitler.
Yeah, and the Mussolini kids. KIDZ. Lil Hitler. Very funny.
Nice. The TV shows were all ultimately nonviolent. You know, even Steve Austin, whose thing was strength, he would throw a person, rendering them unconscious. He wouldn't actually punch them, you know.
Okay.
Did you watch the $6 Million Man?
Yes.
Yeah.
Now, here's something that gets me in every movie and TV show. If the good guy is facing a bad guy, and the bad guy's a big Hulk who could kill him with one finger by snapping his neck.
Yes.
He won't kill him. He'll pick him up and throw him.
Yes.
And
this bothers you.
And yes, and if you're a good guy, you could get thrown 100 feet up in the air, smack against the wall, hit the ground, shake your head, and then he lumbers over to you again and picks you up and throws you again.
Yes, and you're still fine, and you don't do anything until you have wiped your lip and seen blood on your hand.
Yeah,
then you are incredibly strong.
Right.
That's correct.
And it's like these are guys who could kill the good guy with no effort at all.
Well, that's what that turn is in Indiana Jones when he waits for the propeller to take the guy out. Because that movie is all about messing with all of those cliches, all those fight cliches from television and movies of the 70s and 80s.
Do you know Dusty Springfield recorded a theme song for the $6 Million Man that wasn't used?
I did not know that.
Isn't that good trivia?
Is it possible to find it somewhere?
I don't know. But can anyone find it?
Can we somehow put that music under the footage of Bob Hope doing...
Yes, sure. Oh, that would be good.
Sure.
Now, and who was the bionic woman?
Lindsay Wagner.
Lindsay Wagner as Jamie Summers.
She's still with us.
Oh,
very cute.
She was very cute. And my understanding is she's a genuinely decent human.
That's nice to hear.
Wow.
Everybody I hear about who's ever worked with her says, oh, she's wonderful.
We'll call her up.
Please do.
So you watch the $6 Million Man.
And then send her to me and something distracting for my wife.
Watched Man from Atlantis? Did you watch all of these
Man
things?
Man from Atlantis, yeah. And Gemini Man. Gemini Man was essentially the invisible man.
He was a motorcycle riding secret agent.
Yes, but he could turn invisible.
He could turn invisible.
For
Gilbert loves these premises.
For a very specific, I think it was 20 minutes per 24-hour period.
Right.
Never any specificity on whether it somehow resets at midnight.
Or he would die.
Or he would remain invisible forever.
Oh, that's right. That's right.
And he had the first ever we had seen digital watch.
That's right.
Which in itself made him very, very interesting to me. And they had, in this desperate attempt to create suspense where there genuinely was none, they would have a woman always who was his partner with a watch that was counting down his 20 minutes. Because he was in the office while the cleaning lady was there, and he had 3 minutes left to be invisible before.
But, you know, the first digital clock I ever saw was in a movie from the 30s, and it was Bela Lugosi and Boris Karloff and David Manners in the Black Cat.
Impressive.
Yeah.
Wow.
They had a digital clock there.
But was it the kind where the numbers
the type where the wheel
yeah.
turned around?
I love that movie, by the way.
Oh,
that
it's
movie is
so
pure camp.
Strange.
Yeah, it's
I
fun.
I have no memory of the clock in it.
It's one of those movies makes no sense at all, and it just makes it better.
Did you know that The Man from Atlantis was produced by the live-action arm of Hanna-Barbera?
I did not know that.
Also good trivia.
I wonder if they were planning to do a spin-off cartoon if it worked well.
Possibly.
Now, where would the Fall Guy fall into any of this?
Not a superhero.
It came... also, it was later. It was, you know, 10 years later, maybe. But... It had the feel of the 70s superhero shows because it had that same sense of people who are doing something other than actually committing violence. They're faking violence to solve the problem.
Oh, same thing, the Hulk.
When the Hulk caught
a villain,
that's a good example.
He'd throw him in the air, and there was always conveniently either a hayloft there. Or there'd be a lake.
A bouncy house.
Yes, a bouncy
Or, for no apparent reason, a business establishment that had a huge collection of empty cardboard boxes behind it.
Yes,
right.
In the alleyway that popped up in every single TV show.
Stack some boxes here. The Hulk's going to throw somebody.
Loads of empty cardboard boxes.
I loved, and this is a little off topic, but on Mission Impossible, and then they did it sometimes, I think, on $6 Million Man as well, that he would be in Eastern European countries, and they would have signs written in English, but with K's where there should be C's.
Oh, yes.
Backward R, just to make it look a little bit as though we're not even bothering to pretend that we're in a different country.
Incidentally, Majors, and also Richard Anderson, who played Oscar Goldman, is still around. We should do a $6 Million Man. Did you watch these other ones? Did you watch? You watched Man from Atlantis, which was on NBC.
Oh, yeah. And my favorite thing about Man from Atlantis is that there was. And I, even as a kid, I wondered, do they just keep using the same footage? Because there was always a scene in which he's underwater looking at the woman who's the liaison to him through a glass panel. And so she's talking and he's just underwater doing this through the whole scene because he can't talk. Did they just shoot that once or did they go back every week and make
him
go underwater and do the same thing?
He had to shave his body. He had to shave his entire body, Patrick Duffy.
Guy who played Christ? Was that Jeffrey Hunter?
Jeffrey Hunter.
Yeah.
Max von Sydow.
Yeah. This was Jeffrey Hunter. He had to shave his body and especially shave his armpits for the crucifixion scene.
Because we know Jesus was, in fact, hairless.
No armpit hair.
Yeah.
On the cross.
Wow.
Did you know the Gemini Man, which was on in 1976, and only five episodes aired? So I'm surprised you remember
Is that right? So
vividly. The Invisible Man with David McCallum was on at the same time.
It was on at the same time, and it was equally bad.
Yeah. Or maybe they were. Yeah, maybe they were a couple of months apart.
And I
remember music by Henry Mancini, though.
When that Invisible Man was coming on, in the TV guide, they were saying, "Oh, it's the special effects are so much more advanced." And the special effects in the Claude Rains version was so much better than the ones in the TV
show. In 1935.
Yes.
Yeah. All the television special effects from the 70s and 80s were just awful.
Yeah.
And it's part of why I never really enjoyed the Marvel Comics
TV series.
Terrible.
There was a Spider-Man version done with the grown-up kid from Sound of Music.
Yeah, Nicholas Hammond.
And
Nicholas Hammond, good call.
Yeah. They could never get the costume right on Spider-Man.
They couldn't get the costume. And then it was just, they'd show the bad guy, and then they'd show Spider-Man, and he'd do the hand gesture, and then they'd cut to the bad guy and throw a net made of nylon rope at him. That's not how it's supposed to work.
I was watching it through the eyes of somebody who didn't grow up in that generation. I showed it to my nephew. It was over my nephew was 10 at the time, and I was showing him that bad Spider-Man for the 70s. He couldn't believe it. He thought it was a comedy sketch.
Yeah.
He said people took this seriously?
It was so absurd.
And I remember at the same time, like, I don't know if it was like Sesame Street or something, would do like throwing a Spider-Man character. And it was so much better than the TV show.
Yeah.
The costume, the movements.
Now, do you remember any of these, Dylan? We're going to quiz you. Do you remember Manimal?
Yes, I had Manimal in the very first, the night that I got in at the Improv. I'm 17 years old, auditioning at the Improv. And I opened by saying, good evening, I'm so glad to be here. And I'm so glad you guys had the courage to come out here on a night when you could be at home watching Manimal.
Oh, it's a good
joke.
It
was my opening line.
Good punchline. Narration by William Conrad.
Oh, my God.
Do you remember Manimal?
Yes.
Starring the immortal Simon McCorkindale.
He could turn... His special talent was that he could turn into any animal.
He was a shapeshifter.
He could turn into any animal by having a close-up of his eye.
Oh, yeah.
That is correct.
Yeah.
Only 8 episodes of Manimal.
Really?
Aired.
Now, there was also a TV show called Werewolf.
Was there?
I don't remember.
Yeah, there was.
What era are we talking about? Not Lucan, not the boy who was raised by the wolves.
Oh, Lucan.
Lucan? There was a show called Werewolf.
You got me. Yeah. All right, we'll put our listeners on it. How about this one, Dylan? The Powers of Matthew Starr. Does this mean anything to you?
Was Lou Gossett? Was he the son of Starman?
He was a high school student. He was from another planet. Gilbert loves these premises.
Yes, I do remember this.
He lived with the school janitor, who was played by Lou Gossett.
I believe, I may be wrong, there was a movie that I think was called Starman. About an alien, and I think...
Well, Starman is a good Jeff Bridges, John Carpenter movie.
Yes, that's the one. Yeah. I think this was the movie, the TV series that was made because that movie had come out. I may be wrong.
Now, Starman, if we're talking about the Jeff Bridges and Karen Allen...
Good flick.
And I remember a Deuce Chill video that they put out at the time with... Jeff Bridges, to tie in with the movie, Jeff Bridges and Karen Allen singing to each other romantically, dream, 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 dream.
And you got douche chills from this?
Yeah, you got to look this up.
Okay.
You got to look it up.
Okay.
And I want you all the time, and I need you.
You know, it's a B movie, but he gives a brilliant performance.
He is good.
He is a terrific actor.
Even though he hates me.
Well, we'll get into that another time.
Okay.
Do you know who was on The Powers of Matthew Starr?
Who?
James Caan.
Oh, my God.
You're a buddy.
He was. I love James Caan.
Has he done the show?
Yes.
He has done the show.
You know James
Caan
if you saw him. We'll show him to you.
He was the Pathmark man years ago.
He's in Poltergeist. He's the guy that sells them the house. He's the realtor.
He's like, there was a time period where there wasn't a movie where he wasn't there in a business suit.
Right.
He was in a Sunday...
In the Park with George.
Any Given Sunday.
That's a very different movie.
With Al Pacino.
That's right. That's right. Here's one more for you.
One more for
Dylan.
Me.
Dylan, and if you know this one, I'll be really impressed. Automan. This is the 80s now. I've jumped.
Automan, yes.
Another Glenn Larson show.
I believe he turned into a car. He was a cop's partner.
Something like that.
There was Tron-like glowing.
It was a Tron knockoff.
Yes.
Speaking of Jeff Bridges.
He had a lot of pinstriping.
Starring Desi Arnaz Jr.
Desi Arnaz Jr., that's what it was, yeah.
Because if you want to spin off Tron, get me Desi Arnaz Jr.
Yeah, he was an android who was connected to his car.
He was an AI. He was an artificial intelligence being. The premise is Desi Arnaz creates an AI crime-fighting program that generates a hologram. And he leaves the computer at night to fight crime.
Right.
Right.
Right. It had to be at night because it was all about how he glowed.
Correct.
The whole show.
Automan? You don't remember any of these shows, do you?
Not Automan.
That was in 1983. Wow. It aired 13 times.
I don't think I watched more than 2 episodes of it.
Right.
But it's the kind of show that I would have been so excited about that I would have seen it and then been disappointed. And if it was 83, then I was already old enough to have at least some sense of taste and decorum.
Well, I cheated because you said 70s, but I jumped.
You know what? That wasn't a superhero show.
Yes, I do.
Yes.
Petticoat Junction.
Yes.
You're right.
I mean, in mid-70s,
more clues.
Night Gallery.
Oh, yeah.
Night yes. Gallery, to me, was one of those shows that had, if you wanted to know everything that was wrong with 70s television.
See, I liked Night Gallery.
Yeah.
Maybe I was too young.
They had a handful of them that were good, but boy.
Some that were moody.
Yeah. Some of them were so bad.
It was trying so hard to be noir.
Yes.
And failing so badly to do so.
In the Twilight Zone's footsteps, which was yeah. impossible.
As long as we're on that kind of thing, do you remember Harry O?
Sure, with David Janssen.
Came out the same year as Rockford Files.
Yeah, right. That was trying to be like, yeah, that was definitely a film noir.
It was, yeah. And I loved it. I watched it. And then Rockford Files stayed on and Harry O went away.
And the rumor about David Janssen all those years was...
Is this like a Danny Thomas
thing? No.
David Janssen...
He wouldn't do that to you.
...would lie under a glass...
Stop!
And for some reason, they played Danny Boy while he was like...
Yeah.
No, but they would... There was the belief going around at that time that David Janssen was the illegitimate son of Clark Gable.
Oh, yes. I've heard that. We talked about this on a previous show.
Oh, I love this rumor.
Not sure it's true.
I would like to spread a rumor that I am the illegitimate son of David Janssen.
Go for it. Go for it.
And I'm the illegitimate son of Chuck Connors. Yes.
I've heard that.
I see the resemblance between you and Chuck Connors.
And what they used to do on Night Gallery, they'd have these blackouts that were of Love American style.
Yes.
And they would, I don't know how many times they would pull the gag of a guy dressed up as Dracula, and he'd be at the blood bank. And that was like the big joke. Yeah.
We got to get Arnold Margolin, who wrote the Love American Style theme and created the show.
Yeah. Love American Style.
I ran into him at
one
a party.
One of the things that makes me feel most loved on a podcast is when the hosts discuss throughout it who else they should get on the show.
We do that on every show.
Is vaguely interesting, but you know who we should really get is somebody.
We do that on every show.
I would like to see some of those old Love American Styles. Now.
No, you
They're
wouldn't.
They're not holding up.
No, they do not hold up. There is so much television that does not hold up
now.
You watch it and you go, what were we as a society? Oh. Have you ever tried to watch an episode of Welcome Back, Kotter?
No, sir.
Oh,
my God. Not going down that road.
I had trouble watching it when it was
me
on.
Too.
So.
See,
me too.
I think 4 years, 5 years younger than you are, I think. And I was young enough that when it came on, I was just pleased to see someone doing Marx Brothers. You know?
Well, he was a big Groucho guy.
And the show was structured as Marx Brothers.
Robert Hedges was doing Chico.
Yeah, only he talked and laughed.
Yeah.
And, Ron Polillo.
No. Robin Hedges.
Yeah. Epstein.
Epstein.
Yeah. Epstein.
Go, hey.
Oh, right. Epstein was doing Chico.
Right.
Ron Polillo was doing Harpo. That's right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Ron Polillo was doing a Harpo thing all the time.
And what I love, both of them, both those actors died in the same year.
Yep.
And the Emmys was able to save time and money by showing one clip.
God.
From Welcome Back, Kotter, and it covered both of them. They were both in the clip.
By the way, Josh Travolta's Margaret Dumont was underrated on that show. Where can people find out about you?
Go to DylanBrody.com. You can follow me at Twitter at Dylan Brody. You can go to my Facebook page at The Dylan Brody. You can buy all of my 5 CDs from Stand Up Records at Amazon.
And you do a lot. You write novels and you open for David Sedaris and you do a lot of cool
Just
shit.
Just find me. Come see me. I enjoy people.
Good.
You guys are fun.
Thank you for coming and talking to us about a bunch of nonsense.
Thank you for sitting in a small room with me on a sweaty day in New York.
We've enjoyed it. Give our love to Danny.
I will indeed. I'm going to call him right after this and say that I don't think they hated me.
And this has been Gilbert and Frank's Amazing Colossal Obsessions, once again recorded at Nutmeg with our engineer, Frank Bertarossa.
Thank you, Frank Bertarossa.
I'd be glad I didn't bring up Electra Woman and Dynagram.
Oh, yeah. She was a retired alcoholic superhero and Dinah Girl.
I don't remember.
Worshipped her and wanted her to get back into the business.
It was kinky and weird.
Yeah.
Thanks, Dylan.
Thank you.
Colossal Obsessions.